Welcome to the next talk. This talk is given by Ansgar Schmidt. He describes himself as a full-time nerd, which is probably the best description for everyone here in this conference. He loves doing things on embedded developing, soldering, mobile robots, server backend hacking, perfect, interesting things. And he will tell us today about an open source implementation, Apache OpenWhisk, which is something that you may know as an open source implementation of things like Amazon Lambda. So please have a warm welcome to Ansgar Schmidt.
Yeah. Moin, moin. Can you hear me? Does it work? Yes? Okay, cool. Hello and welcome. First disclaimer, I work for IBM, so you will see in between some IBM stuff, but I'm definitely not here to sell anything from IBM. It's really about an open source project done by IBM, but really open source. Everything runs under Apache, so there is really, it's about open source and installing it on yourself, so not selling IBM. The talk is about functions, or very bad word is serverless computing. I'm not a big fan, some marketing guys invented it, and you will see what the idea is behind, but this is just, I don't like this word, so let's stick with functions. The idea is when you see different kinds of workload you have, or different programs or projects you have, there's a different variation of services or places where you can run your code. One is bare metal, when you need full control, everything, but then you have also a lot of things to do with handling really with hardware, operating system, and so on, and you don't always need it. And you next level of abstraction, if you want to say, where you lose a lot of power, but you don't have to take care of everything, then it's virtual machines, as we all know, EC2 from Amazon, for example. Then the next one is container, Dockers, Kubernetes, all this stuff. You're even having less to care about, but you have much more freedom to do. You can more focus on your stuff. And the next level is functions, and this is not about quality of hosting, it's not about quality of service, nothing. It's just about caring less about infrastructure or hardware or anything, taking more care of your functions. And therefore, there are no more servers you need to control. They call it serverless, which is just stupid. It's still about that someone has to take care of servers. It can be a company like Amazon, it can be a company like IBM, or your own computer if you want, and therefore this OpenWhisk project is very interesting because it's not bound to one company, where you have a vendor lock-in, where it only runs on their system, and you have to pay whatever they charge you. You can just develop it in OpenWhisk, and it's running on your own hardware, and there's no one in control except you. And it's about freedom of choice in this case. If you aren't in a vendor, how it's charged is normally about gigabytes per second, because your function only runs normally for some milliseconds or seconds. And so if you just ask a hoster to let it run, it's very, very fine granular, and you just pay per use what you really use in this fine granular matter. The concept of OpenWhisk, as you can see here, is like it's triggered by events, and events is like a source. This can be a change in a database. This can be someone called a URL. That can be, if we talk about IoT, it can be some sensor data coming in. And these are triggers, which get triggered by a source, and then you define rules. What happens when a certain trigger was triggered? And it can be one or two or many rules, which then activates actions. And actions are just very tiny little programs written in Python, for example. And this can be, as it see here, it's a gear, that can be many functions calling each other, working together, and giving you a result. So each and every event outside just triggered a cascade of actions and giving you the answer. And the nice part, compared to, for example, bare metal or even Docker, there is, if you don't have any event, nothing is running. Your server is just idling. There is no active Docker something running. And when one event comes in, it triggers in cascade. And when 1,000 events come in, 1,000 events will be triggered. If you have it on a bare metal machine, well, there is limitation. If you're running it somewhere in a cloud run by a hoster, There's no limitations, it's just the price. But that's again, it's a choice if you want to have it on a hoster or run it on your own hardware. Inside OpenWhisk, how it's done when you set it up on yourself or even if you want to contribute to OpenWhisk, as I said, it's completely open source on GitHub. There is the whole system, it's controlled by a CLI, it's a REST interface, normal one, with an NGX in front of as a reverse proxy. Then you have the OpenWhisk controller with a load balancer and an activator. It just handles your zoo of Docker containers. Then you have for sure some databases, some storage with information. And at the very end, on the right side, you have many, many, many Docker containers. And each and every function you wrote, even if it's a one-liner, it's one Docker container. And this Docker container is not always active, as we see here. Because if you have, let's say, 1 million lines or 1 million functions inside, you don't want to handle all the time 1 million Docker containers. It's just a huge amount of resources you lose. So you store all these functions in a database. And if there was no activation for, let's say, a day or 2 days, everything will be pruned, and you only have the database entry. And as soon as the first event comes in, it takes some time because there is a new Docker container instantiated, takes your code, just copy it out of the database, inside a container, and starts it. It takes some time. It's sometimes 500, 600 milliseconds. But the next event comes in, it's only, let's say, 2 milliseconds or 3 milliseconds because it's already, this container is already active. And just to run a next container, Docker is really, really fast to start new containers. And after some days, you can configure it. This will be pruned again. So if you're running it on your own system, you can configure it. If you run it somewhere hosted on some servers, you can either you can just pay more to keep an active container, or you just trigger from time to time, let's say every 20 minutes, you just call your function with dummy data to keep it active and alive. So it's more, you're getting to the right side. It's about performance and also resource prices. What kind of languages are supported in OpenWhisk right now out of the box? JavaScript, Swift, this is iOS server-side implementation. Java, Docker native, which is quite nice if you have really, let's say you need to compile C code or you have some really complicated Python libraries, Open Computer Vision or something, where you need compiled source code, not only Python, then it's quite nice to have a Docker container or Python 3 with all kind of libraries you want to have. This is already there. Inside the OpenWhisk implementation. And from community effort, a lot of people just contributed their own environment, so you can run it in many, many other languages if you want. But for now, let's focus on Python and Python 3 example. There are ways, as I said, you can just trigger it from outside, like here. I don't have a mouse. You can call a URL. Inside OpenWhisk, it will be handled. You can do some, I don't know, database access, whatever you want to do, and give back an answer. And many, many companies are already using it or even actively contributing to it and investing time and money to continue with it. And it's on GitHub, so even if these companies are leaving the project, you don't lose anything. Yeah? It's just like slowing down the project, but community can also contribute to it. So let's have a little demo time. If you want to follow me, I put all the things I'm running now, I put on Gist, so you can just the shortened URL from bit.ly below, you can just see it. With the network inside here, it's a little bit hard to use it. You can give it a try, but you will see all my live demo stuff here. Let's see here. So, can you see it more or less, or should I increase it? Well, how do I? What was the control shift? No, command shift. Yeah, here, like this. Cool. So, what are we going to do? First thing is, as I said, working for IBM, and we have OpenWhisk as well. I'm using our own OpenWhisk implementation, but you can install it on your own. Let's go back to here. As I said, everything is on GitHub. You will find it under Apache and then Incubator OpenWhisk. Here's all the source code. If you just want to play with it for trying it on your own laptop or somewhere, there is a so-called Vagrant installation. Does anyone know Vagrant? Oh, cool. Yeah. So it's just easy. Check it out here. Run it. Take some time, and then you can start your own actions and play with it. And that's runs locally on your laptop. If you want to do a serious installation for your company, then here there are some. Let me go back. Oh, internet. Yeah. So here is a Docker Hub where you find under OpenWhisk all kind of Docker containers already configured. And by using these Docker container, using Kubernetes, you can set it up on a serious environment and have your functions running and work with it. Here's also a short description how to set up the Kubernetes for OpenWhisk especially and what you need for it. For the documentation, so what I'm doing today is I've stolen a lot from this documentation here, all the examples. So as I said, we have events, trigger rules bounding this trigger to an action, and then sequences, which is just a cascade of actions inside. And so for all these, you have a documentation here, for example, the action here, if I'm getting in, you're seeing here, I'm jumping directly to Python. And then it's like, hello world, to really doing more complicated stuff. And down here also the, somewhere down here, how to use Docker. Somewhere down here you will find it. So let's get into it. The first thing, as I said, all the control is done by a RESTful interface, and there is a nice wrapper around this as a command line tool. It's called VSK, WSK for WISC. You can download it from many places. I have it here now running. And for instantiation, you just set it up like so. You just set it up like this. You basically set a property, where is your host you want to connect to, and what's your authentication key you get from this host as a user when you configure a new user. And then your WSK is connected to it. And first thing is just call it. And then we get the typical thing, what can we do with it? For example, work with actions, work with packages, rules, and so on. And we can, one is like VSCar list, which just lists up everything we have in our server running right now. I cleaned it before, so nothing. But if I want to get more information on the command, like always, help, and you're getting information about it. So let's run the very first function. I have here a very, very simple one. So when you write Python functions, you need to write a main function. That's the condition for it. And you're getting a dictionary as the only argument. And so I'm just getting name. If it's not there, I'm getting place, and I'm just creating this very simple string. And I print it just on a console. And I send back another dictionary. So the whole communication inside OpenWhisk is always done with dictionaries from Python point of view. And let me install it. So that's a command where you just activate it. So you can create one or an update. And if it's not there and you use update, it's like create. So I use always update for it. If you do a VS list, we will see now we have an action. It's in my namespace. It's quite important. We will see it later. Has a num, has a function. And because of the ending, OpenWhisk assumes is Python. And if I don't configure it, it starts with Python 2. But I can also say, like, it's Python 3, and then it runs with a different environment. So let's invoke it. So that's where you just do it by hand. I invoke it, and we just get back, okay, it runs, but I don't see my output, I don't see anything. So for debugging purpose, I can say just give me the result, and I will see here. Is it? Oh. Okay. I try to. Oh. Okay. Was it gone a long time? Okay, cool. So if I call it with result, I'm just getting the dictionary back. But what I always want to do is also like seeing log files. And log files is quite easy. I just print to a command line console. There is one command like about the activations and list up everything regarding to a special name with only the last three calls. And we see here, that's the one, and that's the one I tried before. So that's this one, and I can just say, get me this one. And then I'm getting back a JSON with all kind of information, like what was my limitation configured on the server to run it? What was some path, and what kind of runtime environment? And also here, I see my log file. As I printed only one to standard out, it was this one. But quite interesting here is the duration. Unfortunately, I tried it this morning, and it's still in cache. Otherwise, you would see some values like, 600 milliseconds or so. But as it was already in a cache, it's only 4 milliseconds. If you only want to see the log files, you can just say instead of get, you can ask him for logs. And then you will only see your log file for this application. Everything is RESTful, so you can even easily script it with Python itself. I skipped the other part where I just called it many times to see there is a different variation in timing. So call different functions to call. There is code like this one. Okay. If you want to call a function from within another function, you can just ask your environment for where's the host namespace, the one I showed you before, what are my credentials, so my secret key, just split it in username and password because it's both in here, and then you do a normal REST call to OpenWhisk itself, call a function, and like this one here, action simple Python, and inside here I can give parameters like I want to wait for it because it calculates and I need the answer, or I just want to start a cascade. Things will work on its own and doing more stuff. For example, you're getting a picture upload to a database. Then you started a cascade like, get me the picture. One is responsible for making a thumbnail. The other one is responsible of, I don't know, some doing some analytics on the picture and so on. And that's, you don't, as a starting script, you don't need the answer. You just fork it and you are done. We can just skip it to let it run. Another thing is packages. As you see here, I have a function here, but I have no packages. I only have a namespace. So what I can do, let's see what other packages are already installed on the system. So I ask for the core packages. And we're seeing different stuff like, I want to have a push notification. It's already there as a package I can just use. There are some samples. There is access to GitHub, to weather, to a database, and so on. If we want to dig into it, let's say the samples here, hello world. So now we're getting a JSON back about this description, about everything. Or as a human being, I can just ask for, give me a summary. So I'm just getting only a short version here. And you're seeing the package samples inside OpenWhisk has stuff like greetings, hello world, world count, and so on. And now if I want to know more about, for example here, if I want to know more about the greetings, I don't ask for the package again. I just ask for action now because I'm really digging down here. And I want a summary as a human being again. And I'm seeing here like, oh, it has two parameters, returns a friendly greeting. So let's give it a try. If I call it without anything, just like before I invoke it, I want to get the result. In this case, I'm using the full namespace here. Before I only used like simple Python, but now I need to access the different package. I let it run, and we see, well, I'm getting this normal answer. As soon as I provide, this is how you provide dictionaries entries. Then you see, well, it just uses this one. If I want to use a package, I can bind it, like this one here, where I package bind to my own space, give it a name, and I already want to give some parameters. Like, for example, if you want to access a database, you already want to give credentials to it, not to have it every single call you're doing. So you can do it like this. If I list it up, I will see now, well, there is a new package, and this one is a private, but it's mine. If I get, for example, like here, getting now the summary, it's the same like the original package, because it just used this one. If I call it, like here, that's the sample greetings, the place is already configured over here. Where's someone package? Yeah, here's the place is already configured here, and I only provide the name and to use the already configured one. But if I want to have it, I can just overwrite it like here. If I want to create my own name or my own system, I can do it like so. And with this one, it's easy to share it later on. Like so, share, then yes, and everyone on the same system can just use my package, and so I can work in groups and share the stuff. Let's scroll down here to sequences. This is quite important. If you don't want to always call a function from in a function, but you can just create a sequence from outside, so it's more orchestrating when you know what kind of dictionary gets in and gets out of each function. So let's use this, the systems. In utilities, there is one which is called split. This is this one here. Splits a string. If I want to give it a try, I can just pipe in here my payload. This is just a string in a payload, so that's a convention. He expects a dictionary payload, and he returns the dictionary lines, and then only the lines. And then there is another one, which is called sort, where I just put in lines, as we see here, and he sorts the lines and gives me also the length parameter back. So I can easily combine it. When I put in here in a split, I put a payload, he returns lines, he consumes lines and give me an answer lines. I can combine it like so, where I can say, again, an action like before, but in this time, I create a sequence, very important, and then I just give a comma-separated actions as a parameter, like first use split, then use sort, that's all. If I have it then here, we're seeing I have an action, but that's a sequence from kind of type. If I call it now, like so, where I call my action as parameter, I have a payload. I hopefully get back now the lines, and the lines are sorted. So I can just orchestrate my functions on a bigger level and reuse all the tiny little functions without just digging into it and changing code inside. If you want to use a web API, you can just do it shortly. It's under 5. I have here a very, very simple Python code. Again, takes arguments, has a standard reply. In case name is present, he creates this string. Otherwise, he returns only the message from above. And this, as you can see, body, this is really like the HTML answer I'm sending back. So that's body, header, everything I can set in here. So if I invoke this guy, I give furthermore, instead of only action update, I give also web, like web is true. And when I ask now for the, please give me the URL, I'm getting absolutely valid URL. I can just call here web test, and we see, please give us your name, or I can make it bigger. If I add the name to it, he will use this parameter and work with it. So then trigger and rules. As I'm running out of time now and we have 5 minutes for question and answer, Should we use this one to show you more how to use it, especially sequences and access to database stuff, or do you have questions so far? So, okay, let's continue. Trigger and rules, can you give me then 2 minutes before? Thanks. So trigger and rules. Again, let's have here a look. There is a package called alarms. That's a very simple trigger where I can, for example, set up a cron job. So this is this one here, alarm. This one, alarms. I give him a cron job. I can do it like so. A little bit different than from Linux. I have a 6 parameter here, which is seconds. So I can tell him, well, call me every 8 seconds, and give me a payload with just name and place. So triggering or starting it, and now we only have a trigger. If I have here, we see now here I have a trigger, and if I ask activations poll, no, activation, sorry, activation poll, we should see every 8 seconds now that something happens, hopefully. Well, yeah, here we're seeing the trigger, and now we can. With a rule, we can combine this trigger to a different action. For databases, let's see here. Can you close the door? Because it's so. Again, there is one as one example. It's Cloudant, which is the IBM name for CouchDB. So that's absolutely like CouchDB. We can get it here as a summary, and then we will see there are different kinds of like work with queries, work with indexes, everything, but also very simple ones like read, write, and also trigger. And let's have a look here. Now I'm doing exactly the one before where I use package bind, the one where we just used this Valhalla example. I'm taking this one, call it my Cloudant, and provide him already as a default parameter for the package, provide him with parameters, host, and so on. So I bind it. Have a look here. Now I have it here as my private package. Then I can create out of it, I can create a trigger based on a feed from this one, where I just ask, give me the changes, which database, and I only want 100 triggers for now. If I fire it up, I know he said he has now another trigger. We see it. Over here, my Cloudant trigger. So whenever I change something, I get a call. And now I can, for example, that's how I write to it. I just invoke the action write, wait for it, and give him parameters like which database, and doc, as it's a JSON database. I just put in this one. The same is with read. If I read the same entry back, and now I can, like before, let me scroll down here a little bit. For example, this one, I take a sequence, or I create a sequence where I say, read. This one, when you read something, put it in your own action. In this action, I just work with some kind of whatever I want to do with a document I just got from the database. And then I do a write, and within my code, here, I just return an entry or a dictionary with the database name, and then the doc, and I'm done. So that's how easy I can just work with databases and do it with. So we have 1.5 minutes, no, zero seconds left for one question. Half a second, okay.
Yeah. Okay, so. First of all, thank the speaker for this nice talk. And then we have spent most of the time of the question for the last demo. We have one question.
Hi, thanks for the talk. What's actually the selling point? Nowadays with Microsoft,